big dreams.
You want fame? Well, fame costs. And right here is where you start paying in sweat.
Fame. How could you forget its name? Its high voltage music and high energy dance first lit up our screens in 1982. At the New York School of Performing Arts, music, dance and drama were on the curriculum, and jamming was on the menu at lunch. But does fame cost?
The price of fame can be so many things. It could be a marriage, it could be your health, it could be loneliness.
What did fame cost me? It cost me my youth. My youth, I could have been a regular kid. No, it didn't cost me at all. It bought me some fun musical toys.
It's really like a lack of sleep and anxiety. You know, that's a cost. You know, you have a lot of pressure on yourself.
Yeah. Price of fame could be enormous. The cost of that, maybe some sweat and some tears. But sweat and tears aren't always a bad thing.
There's a craving to have that kind of life again, where everything is very exciting all the time and you're very, very taken care of and everybody does everything for you. It's very seductive.
Just as quick as you had it, it can go. Just much more harmful than never have had it before.
Here on BBC One, in 50 minutes, New York School for the Performing Arts is the setting for Fame.
Body language. All you got to do is make a little move with your body language.
The TV series was a spin-off from Fame the movie. Characters change, but the story was the same. The series followed a group of students with different backgrounds and talents, but all with the same ambition, to achieve fame. Its success in the States was eclipsed by the heights it reached in Britain. It was a phenomenon.
The kids from Fame have turned television fiction into fact.
The producers put the songs and dance on the stage and took Fame on the road.
I didn't even know how much we were loved till we got off that airplane in London and there were hundreds of people there to meet us at the airport, and then they were rocking the bus.
First stop on their 8-day visit will be Brighton, followed by Birmingham and London's Albert Hall.
It was the first time I'd seen the vigil of people lighting a match, and they knew all the songs. I mean, I thought we would like the Beatles all of a sudden. I was like, oh my God.
Six central characters created the unique Fame chemistry. Stubborn dancer Leroy, determined actress and singer Coco, wisecracking comic Danny, bubbly ditzy actress Doris, and the shy musical genius Bruno. You could say. And ruling them with an iron fist and her wooden cane was dance teacher Lydia Grant.
From Fame, will you welcome Valerie Landsberg? Val, welcome to Top of the Pops.
The kids from Fame achieved three top 20 singles, and the album hit number one for 12 weeks.
From the television series Fame.
The kids from Fame.
But I know I'd only last for a couple of days.
For the first time in 20 years, we are bringing together the leading stars of Fame to recall their adventures on and off screen, and to perform their highest charting single, Star Maker.
Going to Debbie Allen's dance studios in Culver City, and we're having the big reunion. Bruno had this sense of wanting to break down the old conventions and replace the real acoustic strings and instruments with synthesizers.
Will you please stop being funny?
I wasn't being funny. Violins are on the way out. It's the truth.
I spent a little while last night learning Star Maker again, because it's been over 20 years since we all played and sang that song. Bruno had the best of the best. He had all these, a mini Moog, and he had an ARP, and he had things that were thousands of dollars at the time.
If you've got a keyboard and some oscillators and the right combination of waveforms, you wouldn't need to make all these dinosaur tracks.
You know, the idea of having access to those electronic instruments was just a dream to me, you know.
I want you to give your undivided attention and a great big hand to a new kid on the block, a star of tomorrow, Danny Amatullo.
Friday night's gonna be all right, it's gonna be right, it's gonna be all right now, baby. Friday night's gonna be all right, gonna be right. Something like that, right?
I think the character Danny was a little more subtle. I don't think he was as abrasive as Carlo is.
I'm not a dancer or a singer. I'm a comedian.
Do you see me laughing, Amatullo?
No.
Then you better start singing and dancing.
I saw Jean a few years ago in Milan. I just saw Valerie last week, so you had to invite her.
Erica, I, run into in town sometimes.
Coco Hernandez was an amazing character. I think one of the greatest things about her was that she never took no for an answer. I mean, this is somebody who is like, I'm going there, and I'll do whatever I have to do to get there.
Mr. Martelli, it is so sweet of you to give us a ride.
That's no big deal, honey. Where are we going?
We're going to 121 Christopher Street.
Well, that's just around the corner.
I know.
We could have met us there.
But it looks so much better to pull up in a cab, don't you think so?
I was in school, and the director of the drama department told me I got the part. And I literally wept. I was like, really? I was like happy and terrified and scared at the same time, because it was a feeling of like, wait a minute, but I love my school. Where am I going?
Erica Gimple, who played Coco, was very serious about being an actress.
You ain't seen or heard the best of me yet. We're going to handle that right here and now.
But she didn't really know how to dance so well. She could learn. She learned. But she would always say, why do I have to dance, and why do I have to move and be so sexy?
Take me, baby, and never let me go. Shake me, if you want me, you gotta let me know. Take me, baby, and hold on tight, cause we're gonna make all the love that you can take.
Hello! Hey, how are you?
Good. No, I auditioned for the movie, and I was stunned when I didn't get the part in the movie. So I thought, if I don't get the part in the series, I'm out of show business. I'm giving up acting.
Danny wasn't a dancer, per se, and neither was the Doris Schwartz character.
You could do it.
I can't do it.
Yes, you could do
I
it.
I can't do it.
Will you try it again?
Yes, I'll try it.
Danny and Doris were perfect for each other.
That hurts my finger.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Okay, this time you be the man.
Okay.
There was a natural kind of frick and frack, brother-sister, fighting brother-sister kind of relationship. And that's just what we did. And yet it was also very loving.
There was a lot of this going on behind the camera.
Okay.
The students were joined in their classes by Julie, played by the child prodigy cellist and model Laurie Singer, and aspiring director Montgomery, played by P.R. Paul.
No, Julie, I don't know.
This is no song and dance class. It's English.
Firm but fair, Miss Sherwood was played by Carol Mayo Jenkins.
Seriously, as you take your presumed careers.
Crotchety music teacher, Mr. Sharofsky, was played by top Broadway composer, Albert Haig, who 2 years ago himself made it to heaven.
Well, I'm sort of the star of this number, and if you want to know how my name is spelled, it's L-E-R...
Leroy, let's just let the man watch the rehearsal. We can figure out your billing later.
Fame was Gene to me.
When I first met Gene Anthony Ray, I had never seen anybody with more raw talent ever, just untrained.
He was comfortable as an actor. He was comfortable as a singer.
Here was this amazing ball of energy and fire, and that was sweet and sour at the same time. Can you feel it?
He's the Energizer Bunny.
I had such admiration for Gene Anthony.
You know, he had this physique that was amazing. This was before people started doing steroids.
Feel it in the air. The wind is taking it everywhere. Yeah.
He lived on, you know, Butterfinger bars and you know, just complete junk food. And, you know, the kind of food that I eat and I just get wider.
In 1993, the British press announced that Gene Anthony Ray was dying.
What are you still doing here? You died. Well, thank you. I mean, I know I didn't do my makeup today, but I'm very much alive. Oh, yeah.
I think Gene has died something like 37 times already, if my calculations are right.
They said I died of AIDS. And it was all in London papers. I was in a hospital and I was diagnosed with HIV, but AIDS I never had. But I was quite ill one time.
He's still kicking. Maybe not as high anymore, but he's still kicking.
It'd be great to see those guys, because we were brothers and sisters, really, whether we wanted to or not. We're very close and worked together a lot of hours.
Dance Academy.
Hey! Lee! Don't dance. I won't dance. Don't ask me.
Okay, let's go say hi. Bruno. I mean Bruno. Lee. That's Lil Anthony.
Well, Bruno.
Erica. I couldn't believe
it.
Oh. Hello.
I said the opposite. I said it was a strap.
How are you? This one keeps in touch with me somehow on internet in Europe.
He's amazing.
Go find him.
Go find him. Where is he?
Where is he? Life's good.
My blood.
Pictures
hey.
Now.
Look good, brother.
You too.
Put a little weight and look good. I see you shaved, huh?
Nah. A couple of days ago, I shaved, and then it grew back, and I said, look, I'm not going to let them, they're not going to prove to them that I'm 17 anymore. This is it.
You look 17 still.
Fa, fa, fa.
The High School of Performing Arts in the series was based on the real-life school in Manhattan.
I actually went to the high school for the performing arts prior to getting the show.
In performing arts? You had to do ballet, classical in the morning, and then all your academics in the afternoon.
The energy was the same. I mean, people's passion, I mean, people's excitement.
The dancers always dancing in tights in the streets in New York City.
People really let loose during lunch, and, you know, it was a very high energy time.
In music school, there was spontaneous jamming going on because people had their instruments, and, you know, on an off period, you know, it was very easy to just say, hey, let's go in that room and, you know, you try out this new chart that I wrote. I wrote a new tune for, you know, for a French horn and acoustic bass. Let's try it, you know.
And double, double. Leroy.
I was kicked out of performing arts.
He did go for a year, but I'll let him tell you what he did.
My mouth was my problem. And it was always with the big guns, not with the kids. I didn't have a problem with the kids. Authority. That's what it was.
He had been kicked out of the performing arts school in New York for slapping a teacher.
What do you mean 7 o'clock in the morning to do a plie? I don't think so. I'll see you at 10.
Then
stop.
What tune did you start this at? Very
good. Here's the key, yeah. Ah, right. Out. That's
ouch.
Correct.
Then we'll be transposing that.
And then go study.
As I watch the ships go by, I'm rooted to.
my show.
I keep asking myself why.
And if there's more on the other side, Debbie, where you at? I'll take your part.
Isn't that Thought of Friends? I thought of England.
Yes.
The thought I made.
Yeah. No, that's the second verse.
A little bit crazy.
Wait.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the laziest, sloppiest, dumbest performance I have ever seen in my life.
Life is a celebration.
Life is a celebration.
Just as all the actors were playing characters similar to themselves, Debbie Allen was more than acting her role as feisty dance teacher. She was living it. As choreographer on the series, she pushed the actors every bit as hard in real life as on the screen.
Oh, I'm looking forward to seeing everybody today.
See the headline? Fame is going to live forever. But I tell them, honey, ain't nobody gonna live forever. This is Eartha on a Stick. That was her nickname.
And one and two and three and one and two and three and four and one and two and three.
It's really to correct them. I wouldn't say beat them, but they did feel it every now and then.
What is this, the Monday Blahs or something? You're all dancing like you're wearing hiking boots.
We ain't wearing no hiking boots, but you should consider the fact we ain't got wings sprouting out our backs either.
Meaning?
Well, Debbie's a powerful human being. And the fact that she took to me and loved me like she does and like she did before is more of a blessing than actually doing fame.
I haven't seen Erica Gimple in a long time. I haven't spoken to Lee Carreri in a while. I see Carlo a lot. Gene Anthony Ray, I just lost him totally. He was on his way to Italy and he never came back home. I don't know where he is. I keep hearing different rumors about what he's doing, and it's a concern to me. He's still my baby.
Fame has ended physically. Not Debbie. She'll never go away. Never.
Do you remember the people with the violins on the plane?
Yes.
Do you remember that? That was so violins on the plane?
Yes.
Do you remember that? That was so amazing.
It was lightning and the plane was falling.
How are you?
I can't believe I'm sick. Where have you been?
Hello.
I'm gonna whip your ass. You've been gone for 3 years.
Hello.
Oh, Erica. Oh, you're so beautiful. You're
Hey.
That's good, Johnny.
Please, look, I tried to call you back.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, and I don't know what happened. Hello, little mommy.
Although set in New York, the whole Fame School was constructed in a studio in Los Angeles.
You want fame, well, fame costs. Right here is where you start paying. Page 26 in sweat.
Gene has gone back to visit what was his daily haunt for 6 years.
This used to be full of classrooms. This was busy. And now it's just a big hangar. It looked like a hangar for airplanes. I really don't recognize this like this. Really, I've never seen it empty like this or quiet.
Well, you have to remember you had a bunch of people from New York brought out to California at MGM Studios where they were filming shows such as Knott's Landing, Dallas, and then here comes Fame.
There were radios blasting and music blasting and people singing and dancing.
They used to have to come outside and say, everybody, be quiet out here.
The big thing was stealing the security golf carts at MGM.
We, Lee Carreri, myself, Carlo Imperato, used to get on those things and run around this lot. I was being in character. I don't know why the other guys did it.
It wasn't like we were stealing them. We were just borrowing them, you know.
If it wasn't illegal, if it wasn't bad, we didn't do it. And I have no idea who the ringleader was.
On the show Dallas, they had a swimming pool. On set. Well, it's California, it's summertime, it's hot. Well, where do you think we would go at lunch?
Did we ask? No.
So when they came back from lunch and lounge chairs are thrown in the pool and, you know, plants are knocked over and the set's dripping wet, you know, there were... We got yelled at a few times.
Toto, I don't think we're in the School of the Arts anymore.
Not in Kansas Anymore was a whole episode themed on The Wizard of Oz, which itself was filmed in the same studio as Fame 45 years earlier.
The whole set for 14 days, 2 weeks, was full of Yellow Brick Road.
Valerie's character, Doris, has a dream, and she basically, you know, she becomes Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz.
Follow the Yellow Brick Road. You bet. Follow the Yellow Brick Road.
I'm the Tin Man, which I at least I was appropriately cast, you know, as limber and as flexible as I am in the dance department.
I'm presuming that I could be kind of human if I only had a heart.
And Carlo was the lion.
I'd be in my stride, a king down to the core.
Oh, and he was in a big old lion costume. I felt for him. Never mind the fact that he don't really dance. Tail dragging the floor. I had a bristle from the broom braided in my braids to have the scarecrow look, but I had to sleep in that stuff.
I'd be scratching while my thoughts were busy hatching if I only had a brain.
Everybody grew up on The Wizard of Oz.
It was that The Wizard of Oz was filmed on our stage, too.
Yeah, so that was history.
We saw the original Yellow Brick Road. I remember somebody was showing us.
It's like The Wizard of Oz goes disco.
We're off to see The Wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz.
It was absolutely, absolutely painful to rehearse dance steps every day for a few weeks and go in, and there it was on film, you know, the naked truth of the tin movements.
Why are we doing, you know, The Wizard of Oz? I mean, that was the biggest joke for me. You know, a lot of people talk about it, you know, and I'm sure it was very entertaining to an audience and everything. But from an actor's point of view, I remember saying to myself, what? I just thought that the show could have been hardcore, you know, could have really showed what's out there on the streets and what young people, you know, young actors deal with.
Let me give you a little advice. No. Let me give you a little opening night present.
Nah, that's okay.
Come on. You want to go out there next Thursday feeling like a schlump? You want to make the people
The song and dance was often woven around a moral issue. Fame dealt with eating disorders, mental illness, racism, the importance of friends, and the dangers of drugs.
I don't want to be a schlump out there, that's for sure.
Well, we started out Fame with an amazing executive producer, writer, Bill Blinn. And he understood how to write from the heart. And he wrote compelling stories.
Fame became bigger and bigger, and it wasn't all because of pliés and high kicks. That had something to do with it, but it was the message.
You're on uppers, aren't you?
Sherwood, if you're finished,
hold your hand up. Hold it out.
I'm just nervous about the performance, that's all. I'm just a little on edge.
Damn it!
If you think about it, we were constantly being parented by the teachers. You know, really, Miss Grant was the parent to Leroy, and Shirofsky was the parent to Bruno.
Miss Harrison, this is a ballet class. It's not modern, not jazz. We don't boogie here.
Black women ballerinas, wasn't, you know, the norm at that time.
I simply believe that black bodies are not suited to ballet.
Racist nonsense.
Like Doris goes on a diet, and she ends up passing out because she's not eating.
Doss, don't you think you're going a little overboard with this diet stuff?
What diet? Diet's when you eat non-fattening foods. I've been fasting for 3 days and taking these.
You mean you haven't eaten anything?
Look, I'm fine. Just feeling a little lightheaded, that's all. The important thing is that I lost 4 pounds. Count them, 4.
So many episodes were about so many important things.
Are you through with those funny pills? They were on your nightstand.
Now they're in the toilet. Through with them for good.
I thought I had it this time.
Hey. You know that one, don't you?
I thought the dream would be mine.
Was that at the Wadsworth?
Hoping to fly, I fall. Oh, how I wish I just didn't care at all. But when you don't care, you don't cry.
To make it eventually, 'cause I still believe in me.
I love that.
It brings everything back. Yeah.
What was the one we did, though, in that music store?
High fidelity.
All the boys may turn me on, but I let temptation slide. It used to be so plain to see the hunger in my eyes, but now I'm buying, trying.
I don't think anybody ever expected High Fidelity to be this huge hit single. Certainly not when we recorded it. It was just like the silly number, you know, that we did in the music store.
High Fidelity, High Fidelity.
I don't remember why we were at the music store. I don't remember why we were singing that song. High Fidelity, Now, remember, I had a horrible stomach pain that day. And so in between shots, I was lying on the floor, doubled over, just in a fetal position.
We had three music numbers a week. It was just another music number in another episode. I mean, it was really, and there was no choreography. It was just jumping up and down. I mean, I don't think Debbie even was involved in it.
I ended up writing seven songs over my three seasons on the show. They came to me and said, you know what, Bruno makes fun of Sharofsky, and he sings a mock song about Sharofsky. Could you come up with something for us? And I thought, oh, that's the easiest job I'll ever have. You know, make fun of my, you know, my crotchety music teacher.
Tell me the first thing that comes to your mind.
Mr. Sharofsky.
Why not?
Sharofsky. Where's the music, Sharofsky?
What's he gonna say? Have a nice day.
If people really wanted to do something on the show and they lobbied to do it and they spent a lot of time preparing for it, they could do it.
By the time I directed the show, Debbie had been directing for a long time. I was the only other actor, I think, who directed.
When I was approached to be Lydia Grant, the actress, I let them know I would be happy to play that part, but I was much more interested in choreographing and becoming a director, and they said, okay, you can do that on the side.
She choreographed most of them, 85%. She couldn't really dance in all of them because she was choreographing, and she had children.
5, 6, 7, 8, double.
But that didn't stop her. Sometimes she used to choreograph with one baby yelling down here and the other one in her arm, 5, 6, 7, 8. You couldn't stop that girl.
I became the manager, in a way, not just the director, but I had to manage them. And through those dance numbers and through, you know, whatever they were going through, there was always some drama going on.
There was a lot of drugs and alcohol from cast members to producers to electricians, grips, production designers. I think in that era, cocaine was such a big thing, you know?
There was pot, you know, and there was things to keep people awake on the set, but I mean, nothing obviously sponsored by the show.
There were a lot of people getting high, at inappropriate times.
You've been nodding off. I want to know if the cause is physical or chemical.
I'm not sure I follow.
If it's fatigue, get some sleep. If it's drugs, get some help.
Drugs? No way.
But when you have a 5:30 a.m. call, you know, you need to be on the set and you need to be, you know, clear-eyed and have your stuff together. I always tried, you know, to be on time.
I was that very, very high-functioning alcoholic. But I was also the girl who, like, was never late to work, and yet I was in big, big trouble.
They covered a lot of things up because they didn't want that out there, you know.
I was never given the big talk because I was never a problem.
It was almost accepted back then. You know, you weren't put down for doing it, which people should have been.
The big wigs protected their investments.
We actually did the tracks on an airplane.
Desdemona. That was so good.
Ooh, my Desdemona. I love it. It's been so good.
Ow.
You know I wanna own ya. I wonder if I could sing, girl.
Such a fine kind of lady. Making the boy so crazy. There's something you should know about Desdemona.
Don't you ever leave me. I don't know what I do. I just can't believe your love is really true.
And then the horses.
Pretty funny. You look back on some of those shows and see the fashions. Pretty heinous, some of them.
It's the newest thing. It's kind of the pirate look meets the sweatsuit.
Looks like Donald Duck meets the creature from the Black Lagoon.
There were times sometimes Debbie would want me to wear these fancy outfits, you know, and I'd be like, Coco can't afford that. What are you talking about? She can't do it. And she'd be like, just wear it. And I'd be like, no, I don't want to wear it. I don't want to wear it. Fashion for leg warmers was fueled by fame. I definitely think so.
People made them fashionable and bunched them at the bottom to make your leg look longer. They did nothing to hide your butt, so.
As the series grew in popularity, the stars outgrew the contracts they'd originally signed as young unknowns. They tasted fame and now wanted more.
I wanted to get off of the show after the third season.
We signed this very, very, you know, not great contract for 7 years, and it was their option to pick us up year after year.
They wouldn't let me go.
We made no money.
And even if you adjust for inflation from the 80s, you know, we're still looking at salaries that were 1/100th, you know, what people are getting now.
There were a few actors that just wanted more and more and more. More money, more power.
They wanted me to come back and act and direct, and I said, no, I just want to direct. And they were like, well, bye.
It's the big question.
After 3 years, Doris was written out of the series.
Well, this is the place where I discovered the real Doris Schwartz.
I got sober that summer, the year I left the series. And I don't know if that would have happened the same way if I had kept going.
In the third series, the character Bruno was forced to take a job to make ends meet. Lee soon found himself a victim of economics, too.
Thought you were a waiter, not a security guard.
Just watching out for my job.
Since my price had gone up a bit, you know, it was the first thing they cut out were the expensive things.
I really wanted to go and do theater in New York. That was a real dream of mine.
Coco, sorry you didn't get to be a star.
I'm a Sherwood, I'm already a star. Thing is, not enough people know it yet is all.
For me, on a personal level, I had to really check in with myself and go and reground myself. And that's what I did.
By the last program, Danny had been in school for 6 years.
Aren't you ever going to graduate?
I remember being in New York. I'd walk past School of Performing Arts. You know, this is the fifth season. And all of the guys and girls would be outside on the front steps. And they'd scream, Carlo, when are you going to graduate?
You should be
Leroy had graduated and joined Lydia as a teacher by the last episode.
I like my teaching to fall back on. I don't know if I'm ready to get out there and just strike it on my own.
I'm gonna strike you on my own if you don't get on out of here.
The last day of filming was very emotional for everybody, because I think everybody came to the realization that it was over. And not just, you know, cast members, the crew, you know, everybody, people who were there from day one.
Oh, that last episode of Fame breaks my heart now when I think about it, because it was saying goodbye to a time. It wasn't just a show, it was a family.
I feel after 6 years that I just have my wings and I should fly away from this nest. However, I thank you, Miss Grant, who's been my friend and my teacher. You showed me the right way, and you always will.
Those tears in that episode were real tears.
For 6 years, Fame's optimism and energy had lit up our screens. But would Fame live forever?
My swan song. The doors were not open like when you were actually filming Fame. Because, you know, people are like, that show is over. Good luck, ciao, goodbye. It was sad. It's sad sometimes. It's when you look for other things to cover it up. A drink would make me feel better than opening up to somebody. One was too many and a million was not enough. Because you can always have a cocktail with the boys and the girls, especially being famous, without paying. At least for the first 6 rounds. But drugs is drugs. The ones that they say not that bad will get you later. And I'm in love with the worst one, alcohol.
Many of the cast's lives have taken the direction that their characters could have taken.
This is my acoustic piano, which is kind of something that I've always wanted to have. You know, it's something that I just love to sit and relax and play. My studio is back here. It's got to be separate from the house because I'm mixing at all hours of the night. And I can't disturb my wife and kids because they would go crazy.
Once I left Fame, I started working on songs and, you know, and I started producing. I ended up producing Natalie Cole.
You're good.
I started working with Gavin Christopher on a project called Aquabox. Just seemed like a natural thing to do, work on the music side of television, and ended up doing a bunch of episodes of Chicago Hope, and I did this show called Dangerous Minds.
Aaron, you gotta hold yourself.
Debbie has remained in film and television, co-producing Amistad with Steven Spielberg and directing dozens of TV programs, including The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and Quantum Leap. And now she's helping a new generation of dancers reach for fame.
Nice, that's good.
I've started the Debbie Allen Dance Academy, which I think is the most fulfilling part of my whole life, where now I'm really living the Fame story for real.
Erica continues to work as an actress, appearing in programs as diverse as ER and even Babylon 5.
I was playing a singer who was dying of a very rare disease, and I was in love with one of the doctors on the show. But that was really fun, though. I got to compose one of the songs and, you know, sing and put my music to it, which was really great.
She's currently appearing in Repertory Theatre in Los Angeles.
Intimate Apparel. It takes place in 1905 in New York City, and I play a ragtime composer who is a prostitute at night, having to make her living that way.
And let me tell you, a gentle touch is gold in any country.
Carlo now looks beyond acting to more stable sources of income, ranging from shares in gyms to real estate. He's just opened his latest venture, a beauty spa.
We bought this place, and I did all of the construction on it, and my beautiful wife runs it. When I'm not filming, I am also what's considered a prop maker, and that means we build all the sets in the movie studios. That's something I have to work on, because as I'm building them, I have a script and I read the script and see what they're doing, and then when the actors come on, I have to walk off. So it takes some getting used to, but it's another facet of what I do. But I will always be an actor first, always. Since Fame has ended, I have done numerous pilots, which are test series. I've done a bunch of theater, you know, some independent movies. I mean, always keeping, you know, I've always kept busy. I will be back, you know, working as an actor and on TV and on the screen and on stage. I will.
A recent Fame revival in Europe attracted Gene to Milan, where he's been reliving his former glory. Once again, he's found Fame.
Well, did you have fun in Italy, though? Well, you stayed there a long time, though, Gene.
I stayed a while.
You've been gone forever.
The big discos, and, you know, they would say, could you come for a Friday and a Saturday and sing three songs? And I was like, I most certainly can. Yeah, pay you a lot of money to get on stage and shake your booty. And I said, you know, this would go a whole lot better if I did it with transparent pants. But I said, if Debbie Allen finds out, because she used to tell me, boy, put your clothes on, keep your pants up, and now I have no pants on to keep up.
Oh, my goodness.
But that's enough of that. I want to do a TV series again. And we got some offers. We'll go home and read them. Hopefully everything will be okay. I'm drug-free, alcohol-free. Truly would love a cigarette, but we won't talk about, I shouldn't have said that. Mother?
I have a, you know, a really amazing wife. I have these two incredible children. I have somehow managed to stay with the same man for 21 years, which is unbelievable.
Cause you never, never think that the people on the news will be you. And you never, never think
Valerie now writes for and directs television and theatre. She has recently started performing her own music.
Cause you never, never want to be faced with what you can't comprehend.
4 years ago, I was driving around in the car and I was thinking, you know, sometime before the end, I really want to sing with a band.
Cause you never, never know.
Thank you. You're the best. I love you. Thank you. Good night. Thank you for coming.
The episode built around the song Star Maker hid the real-life tragedy behind an actor leaving the series.
Randall. We were losing one of our actors, one of our cast members was actually dying of cancer.
Michael Toma.
And it was like his last episode. And the show, he was leaving the school.
Right.
Right. Because they knew at that point he couldn't really be working anymore.
I had intended to get out of here with as little fuss as possible, because I'm not very good about saying goodbye. I tend to dawdle at the door a lot.
It was like a pre-eulogy because Michael knew he was very sick.
Mm.
And yeah. It was like everyone standing around him saying, this is what you mean to us. This is how
I didn't know until that day that he wasn't coming back to work.
None of us knew.
Mr. Crandall, it isn't easy for us to let you know how sorry we are that you're leaving and how much we'll miss you. So we decided to do it the way we know best.
The ships go by. I'm rooted to my shore.
I keep asking myself why.
And if there's more on the other side. Here, as I see the friends I thought I made, a little bit of craze and wondering now. We've outgrown.
quote saying, you know, fame, we're going to live forever. It sounds great, but it's not the reality.
Being famous, I have no choice.
I never liked the publicity, signing autographs, being treated differently.
You know, I don't know so much if the attention was a problem for me. I'm kind of an attention gal. It's kind of my favorite drug.
I was more into saying, let me inspire you, go do what you need to do.
I feel very well respected. That's what I feel.
Do I like being famous, like big famous? It could be a bit much. People knowing your business or wanting to know your business and writing what they want to write and only judging what they see, it sucks.
I don't regret, you know, having the little taste of fame that I had. You know, I think it was just right and it was just enough. Any more, I think, would be annoying.
Fame is a very significant part of my life. It always will be a significant part of my life. But how lucky am I that that's the significant part of my life?
Here, as I watch the time go by, how I'd like to sail away, leaving all my past behind, but I know I'd only last for a couple of days. Here stands everything I thought I made. It's the only life I've known, and I can't even call it my own. I got no home, I belong to you.
Where, do we do the ending? Do we perform the song?
No, we just kept it going. Then
we
I think
just
we
used
went
a part of it in the melody.
No, but when we did it on the road, we did end it.
We just kept it going.